Now, we're on page 37 of the manual. And we're going to be looking at the principle of moral obligation. Now, I will tell you from the beginning, if you really want to study this out, there's a couple of good books to get on it that have a lot of detail in it. One is Finney's Systematic Theology. Okay, it's like that thick, but it is excellent. And he has a particular section on moral government, moral obligation. I mean, it's just intense. So you really have to go through it. And Finney was a lawyer, and he preached like a lawyer. And so, I mean, it was laid out, but you still have to go in and read it and take this apart and kind of read it section by section. But it is worth the read, no doubt. So, but there's a couple other, there's another one by Dake called Bible Doctrines Unveiled or Revealed or something like that, or Unmasked. That's it, Bible Doctrines Unmasked. And he talks about moral obligation. And so this is, if you'll notice, I approach these things from several different points, but they all end up at the same spot. And so we're going to, the principle of moral obligation becomes the foundation of everything else. And if we establish this, to me, the principle of moral obligation is to a Christian's overall walk what healing in the atonement is to healing. Right? It is the bedrock that gives us absolute authority to believe for any person's healing. Okay? And it's the same thing with moral obligation. Once you do that, once you understand moral obligation, everything else changes because you cannot back off of it. So, first off, the other principles show us how to act. This principle shows us why we must act. This principle, rightly understood, will become the guiding principle for all future action. And with it, you will need no outside influence, right? So now understand that the principle of moral obligation is based upon the laws of God. God set this law, and if you really want to get back to it without getting too, philosophical in this, this principle goes back to a point where you can't define it by anything else because it stands on its own. It defines itself. Now, whenever you get back in the principles so far, almost every principle is proven by another principle. But when you get back to this principle, it proves itself, and it's so self-evident that you can't go back any further. So this is the basis. Just like if you were trying to describe God, it would go along the same lines. Now, understand this. And I obviously don't have time to go into all this and could not include it in the lesson. But for moral obligation to be true, there first must be a moral governor. And for there to be a moral governor would mean someone who has the right to rule because they are absolutely so perfect morally that there is no one better able or better suited to rule. Now, if you want to go back, the only being that could be a moral governor and be that perfect would be God. So the very fact that there would have to be, the fact that moral obligation is true and binding upon man, and all nations, all civilizations, all societies know this to be true, and all law, all true law, is based upon this premise. And the fact that all humanity acknowledges this basic premise of moral obligation, for there to be moral obligation, there has to be a moral governor. So for all humanity to acknowledge this moral obligation, then humanity would also, if they were truthful, have to acknowledge a moral governor, God. So the fact that all humanity has this built into them, whether they're Christian, non-Christian, whatever, I'm talking about just from, just human, regardless of religious affiliations or whatever else. The fact that that every human being acknowledges the truth of what I'm fixing to teach, the fact that they do that proves that they know there must be a God truly. Because you could not have moral obligation without a moral governor to dictate the obligation. Right? So really, it's kind of funny because what we're covering in these last couple of sessions has almost been like a basic course in theology. But you need to understand this because this is where the principles come from. So, now, This principle will become the prime directive by which you operate. Moral obligation is the basis for all civilization. In Ecclesiastes 12:13, Solomon said, "Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God, keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man." That's it. If you fear God, keep His commandments, you have done all you have to do. Now the trick after this is to know what loving God and fearing God is and what His commandments are. So, in Matthew 22, verse 36, it says, "Master," now there, at this point there was a lawyer, there was a group of them got together and they were trying to figure out some things on how they could trap him, and one of them says, "Master, which is the great commandment in the law?" And Jesus said unto him, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." So if you do those two things, you will fulfill the law. Right? Matthew 7, 12 through 14. "Therefore, all things whatsoever you would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them. For this is the law and the prophets." Now, do you realize that that statement stands on its own? You notice there's no qualifications, nothing about leading, nothing about revelation, enlightenment, nothing, right? He said, you want to know how to fulfill the law? Treat everybody the way you want to be treated. Am I right? Now, he is describing what was in Matthew 22. Now, he hadn't said Matthew 22 yet because it's after that, but what I'm saying is that he is, if you want a full description of Matthew 22, it's in Matthew 7. Matthew 22 says, love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. In Matthew 7, he told you how to love your neighbor as yourself. You do to them what you will want done for you. So the great commandment is to love God, right? With all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And then the second commandment is to do what? You would say, love your neighbor as yourself. Well, you could say that, or you could say the second commandment is to do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Right? Because it's the same thing. Now, he says after that, "Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leads unto life, and few there be that find it." Now, do you realize? See, we, in the church, we take scriptures out of context. We just pull them out. We say something and make it stand on its own whenever it is really part of an overall statement. When he said, enter the straight and narrow gate or enter the broad gate, and he said the broad gate leads to destruction, the narrow gate leads to life. See, if I ask most people what those gates are, he's going to say, well, the narrow gate's Jesus. That's the way it's generally taught. But that's not the context of the message. If you look at what he's talking about, he is describing, he said, look, do to others what you want done for you. Now he is saying, that's the narrow gate. He said, because if you do that, then you will live. He says, if you don't do that, then you're going the broad gate. And if you go the broad gate, you won't live, you go to destruction. But if you do the narrow gate, then you will be one of the few that find life. So the narrow gate is not Jesus in the sense of accepting him as master. The narrow gate is to do to others what you would have done to you. Isn't that right? Because Jesus wouldn't tell the Jews at this point to accept him. Right? See this? We go back in and we know the whole thing. We try to mix it all together and we make Jesus act like he's talking to us when he was talking to a specific people that weren't even born again yet. Right? So you have to find out who he was talking to and what were the circumstances and all that kind of stuff. Now, the definition is this of moral obligation. This is a short definition. You must dedicate yourself to and accomplish that to which God has dedicated himself. That's it. If you do that, you are fulfilling the law or the principle of moral obligation. Now, what this means is exactly this. You must truly will, and which means to intend, and accomplish what God wills. Now, do you understand? See, whenever I hear this, you've got to will it and intend it, the same thing that God wills. Then, obviously, in the church, the first thing they're going to say is, well, how can we do that? Because God is so much better than us and all that kind of stuff, which is true. But in essence, he says, and even in was it Luke, I think it is, and several other the Gospels. Jesus said, it is enough that the servant be as his master. And it says that anybody that is perfect will be as his master. And then later on, he even says, be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Isn't it right? So people say, well, that perfect means mature as your heavenly. Okay, that's fine, but it still says, do it as your heavenly Father. So it's saying, be like him and imitate him, and to the same degree he is, you should be. Right? But see, we don't hear that much because we make the distinction most of the time in the church of how much different God is from us. When in reality, as we'd say in Texas, we're the spitting image of him. Okay? That's a real pleasant thought, but I'm just, you got the point across anyway, so. Okay? Now, next. Now, this is where most Christians have a glitch. If there is a glitch at the point of origination, then every action toward the destination will be incorrect. Right? You must start from the correct basis. The ultimate obligation of every moral, meaning voluntarily acting and responsible being, must be to the willing of and the performing of the best good of the entire universe. See, this, again, you get the Finney systematic theology? This all goes into it right here. This is actually excerpt some of it, bits and pieces here. You get a good idea of this. Now, understand this. And again, this will show you the difference between the church. The church, the difference between sinners and saints. A sinner is dedicated to the ultimate good of himself. A saint is dedicated to the ultimate good of the universe. And all you have to do is look at yourself, and honestly, because I can't ask you because you probably won't tell me the truth. But if you look at yourself and ask yourself, what is your ultimate dedication to? Are you truly dedicated to the ultimate good of the universe? Or are you dedicated to the ultimate good of you? Then, because if you answer that you're ultimately dedicated to the good of you, then you are not yet a Christian. See that? Because that's the difference. Because the heart of the Christian, the heart of the Christian is characterized by unselfish love for others. The heart of the sinner is characterized by selfish love for self. This is it. Now, he said, but I know some sinners that are unselfish. Not ultimately. Ultimately, it comes back. And if you ask most people, see, this goes back to the point of why a person gets saved. Like I said at the beginning, remember I said there were three types of people? Some people get saved to avoid prosecution. Well, most people, if they are unselfish, it's because they don't want to be punished for being selfish. Meaning, they're trying to be unselfish because of what it gets them. See, even a sinner. You take a sinner that's a multimillionaire. He may donate millions or even billions of dollars to an organization. But at some point, if you follow the trail far enough, you will find out that the ultimate reason for him doing that comes back to benefit him in some way, even if it's the benefit of how he feels about himself. And if that's true, then that person is selfish. They are not a Christian, even though they're extremely beneficial. Even, you know, philanthropic to people. I mean, they're doing wonderful things. You see? But that's the difference. The Christian does things, what Finney called disinterested benevolence. In other words, a love, you do it because of a love that gains you nothing. Not even the guarantee of heaven. That's why you've heard me before in the DHT where I would call myself a Christian for years, but then it came to a point where, after reading Finney, actually, and some other material, I started asking myself, why am I saved? Why did I get saved? You know, was it to avoid hell? Was it this? And I got to a place where I told God, I will serve you. I'll do what you tell me to do. I'll go anywhere you tell me to go. I'll do whatever. And if, I wasn't just saying this. This weren't just words. I meant it. And it took me a long time to get to a place where I could say this. But I said, if after I have lived a life of service to you, that you find it in the best interest of your kingdom to then put me into hell, I agree. And I'm submitted to your will. And, you know, then people say, well, that's not right. You shouldn't do that because God will never do that. Okay, I understand that. But it was a matter of submission, absolute, true submission. Now, the key is keeping that level of submission. Okay? Saying it's one thing, you know. Saying I do, you know, hopefully that's not the last time you say I do, but many times it might be, right? And so just because you say I do at the marriage, you got to keep saying I do after that, okay? That's the key. Now, here's in the church, we've got people that are in the church because they don't want to go to hell. Okay? Now, I got news for you. People that are in church because they don't want to go to hell are still going to go to hell. Okay? Because the difference with a Christian, their heart has to be changed. There has to be a change of heart. Not just a... See, I hated alcohol before I was born again. So hating alcohol doesn't make me born again. Right? So... You say, well, but I know people that, you know, sinners that quit drinking or sinners that never drink. Okay, so what? That doesn't make them Christian. See, drinking doesn't take you to hell. That's a symptom of it. Do you understand that? Now, if you have these symptoms, then that shows you the problem, that your heart has not changed because you don't love holiness. That's the essence of it. And so, now, notice this. I'll read it to you. You can stay there where you're at, but I'm going to read it to you from the beginning. The ultimate obligation of every moral being, meaning voluntarily acting and responsible, must be the willing of and the performing of the best good of the entire universe, which is to accomplish the will of God, because the will of God would automatically be the highest and most beneficial will for every being in the universe. Now, I said that for this reason. Many in the church will the best good of the universe. They're obligated to, and they submit to it, and they truly will the best good of the universe. They can truly look at situations, horrible situations, and think, God, that's awful, and I wish it was this instead, and I want the ultimate good. I want evil to stop. I want this to stop. People, they'll cry, they'll pray, and they're sincere. They truly willing the good of the universe. But they don't make that step from just willing to performing. Willing alone is not doing. That's the basic problem in the church. The church believes that virtue lies in the willing. The virtue does not lie in the willing. It lies in the willing and then the performing. Okay? That's why he says, be doers of the word, not just hearers. If you're a hearer, you're probably willing. But until you're a doer, you're not a doer. Isn't that simple? Now, if you commit to and truly accomplish the will of God, you are accomplishing the highest and most beneficial service possible for a moral being. And if you are truly committed, willing to will or intend and to perform the will of God, then it's not enough just to know about it. You got to do it, like I said. But you have to be dedicated to the best good of the universe. And when I say dedicated to the best good of the universe, I don't mean saying I'm dedicated to the best good of the universe. You have to say, what is the best good of the universe? That all creatures worship God and know Him. Right? That's the ultimate. Because that is also what God has dedicated Himself to. That all creatures should worship Him and that they all should know Him. That's why He gave the revelation called the Bible. See how all this works together? Yeah. Believe it or not, you're getting a theology class. Okay? I mean, essentially, is what it comes back to. Now, when you commit to the ultimate good of the universe, which is to love God and keep His commandments, at that point, you are performing the highest service possible to a moral being. Now, that doesn't mean that you're doing anything and that the thing you're doing is the highest service. It's the fact that you are performing the will of God. That's the highest service. You see? Now, the best good of the universe, including all mankind, is to line up with and accomplish the will of the Creator of the universe and all mankind. The Creator of the universe must have the overall best good of His creation in mind when He created everything. else he would destroy his own creation, thereby revealing that his will was not for the overall good, but rather the overall bad of the creation. You see how this kind of line, see how this stays within itself? It relies back on itself. You know, it's like inward circular reasoning, right? But the reason it is like that is because it has been condensed to the lowest possible denominator. Now, the principle of moral obligation is founded upon the basic principles of universal acceptance. The most powerful being in the universe would be God. If he's not the most powerful being in the universe, then he wouldn't be God. And therefore, whatever is more powerful than him would be God. And therefore, truly, the most powerful being in the universe would be God. Right? You get that? Okay. You have to kind of sort it out there. I guess if we gave him a name, it'd be easier. Okay? Now we're back at the first premise that whatever is most powerful in the universe is God. Therefore, this is the basic principle of universal truth. If there is a God, mankind should love and obey him. For this ultimate being to be worthy of serving, he would have to personify everything that would be worthy of serving. Right? Now, if he had the highest qualities of existence, his creation would embody and display the same qualities, but not necessarily to the same degree. Okay? That's why we know that we are the creation of God, because we bear the qualities of God and the characteristics of God, just not to the same degree. Now, where are we at here? Yeah. God could know the future outcome of all things at one time. Man cannot, in and of himself, right? If man is therefore the creation of God, man should embody the same attributes of God, but not to the same infinite degree. Therefore, whatever God feels, man can feel, but just not to the degree that God feels it. By the reciprocal, whatever man feels, God can also feel, because man was made in the image of God. So whatever man feels, God can feel, but God can feel it infinitely more, because he has those same qualities would have the same exact feelings, but just infinitely more than what we would have. So we'll see, whenever you say you hurt, God, don't you understand? God, don't you don't know what I'm going through. He can say, not only do I know what you're going through, but I feel it infinitely more than you do. You see that? Because you can't control how much feeling you have. Right? Now, so we know that he truly does know and feel what we experience. Now, a resolution, I said all that to get to this point, a resolution does not mean obedience. Most people try to make a resolution, New Year's resolution or whatever else it is. But they think that making the resolution shows how good they are. You make I'm resolving to be a good Christian. I'm resolving not to sin anymore. I am making a resolution that I'm going to live right. And you think in making that resolution that is a display of your goodness, because it shows your intent. But the resolution, see, your intent is only truly shown when you live up to the resolution. Right? So it's not the making the resolution that counts, it's living to the resolution. Now, you say, can you give me an example? Okay, yeah. Remember when Jesus said there were two brothers? And the father said, go, and one said, I won't go. And later on, he changed his mind and went. And the other one said, I'll go, and he didn't go. And Jesus said, which one did his father's will? Was it the one that said it and didn't do it, or was it the one that said he wouldn't and yet went? And the obvious one was that the one that said he wouldn't but later went, right? Why? Because Jesus didn't say which one agreed with his father's will. He said which one did his father's will. So it all comes back to doing. If you see, that's what all I'm doing is echoing what James said. Faith without works is dead. How can you say you love God whom you haven't seen when you won't love your fellow man who you do see? And how do you show you have love for fellow man if all you say is be warmed and filled and go your way and be blessed, rather than giving what you have to make it happen? So see, if you truly dedicate, see, this should be an ordination class. Isn't it? Because if you truly dedicate yourself to the ultimate good of the universe, meaning to truly love God and your fellow neighbor as yourself, then you have to start asking yourself, you will ask yourself the exact same thing that I asked myself that led me into the ministry. I didn't have a bright light, didn't have a voice from God necessarily. What I had was, I simply asked God, what can I do that would be the most benefit for the most people for the most time? And I realized that it wasn't fast food. It wasn't martial arts training. It was preaching the gospel. And from that day to this, I have preached the gospel. Now, I didn't hear a voice from God saying, go and preach the gospel. I didn't hear that. Didn't have a light out of heaven. But the fruit of the ministry proves that the call was there and that we're doing the will of God. And see, we put a lot of emphasis on there first being a call, but you don't see really much in the Bible, in the New Testament, about call, you know, about callings and that kind of thing, other than doing what you're supposed to be doing. Now, you have Paul say he was called to be an apostle, and you have, you know, the gifts and the callings of God are without repentance, things like that. But I'm saying when you, he also told the Christians, average saints, that's what he talked about in Romans, when he said that they are the called according to his purpose. Well, who is the called? The ministry? He's talking about saints. So the saints are called, right? And he even told the saints, make sure that you walk worthy of your calling, right? Make your calling and election sure, right? So you have all these areas that points not to ministry, fivefold ministry, but to Christians fulfilling the will of God, which should be, I'm not going to say the will of God should be this, their fulfillment should be to the ultimate good of the universe, which is the will of God. Right? You see that? So every Christian, there's no such thing as a minister having responsibilities or callings that a Christian doesn't have in the truest sense. Right? Because whatever a Christian's called to do, I mean, if you look at all the assignments, it's all to Christians. All the stuff, you know, there's some calling to apostle and things like that. And Paul said himself, you know, you see the signs of an apostle, and he gave some of those. But it said believers lay hands on the sick. It said believers cast out devils, right? So all the things that we're generally concerned with are believers' callings that apostles should also do because apostles are believers, right? Now, let's look on. Luke chapter 6, verse 43. For a good tree bringeth not forth corrupt fruit, neither does a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. And see, the church didn't get this. The church has already muddied up the theological waters by saying all kinds of different things, but Jesus said this. For every tree is known by his own fruit. So he's talking about people, right? For of thorns men do not gather figs, nor of a bramble bush gather they grapes. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaketh. Now, Finney said it this way. A person who is not right with God can do nothing right. Now think about that. Now that doesn't mean that, you know, if a sinner sees a person walking across the street and they go out and help them walk across the street, that's not a good work. Because we would look at it and say that action is a good action. But it's not credited to them as a good work because they're not good. And everything they do flows out of an evil heart, so even the good that they would do is evil. See that? That's why it is so important. People say, yeah, but look at all the good works they do. No, it's not. It's coming out of an evil heart. See, you see, all you see is the works. God looks at the heart. And he looks at everything done as from the heart. So everything you do, it takes on the nature of the heart that it comes from. And if your heart is good, then it's good fruit. And if your heart is evil, it's evil fruit. Right? That's what Jesus just said. Now, and why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? You notice he's tying this right in here with fruit. Right? Whosoever cometh to me and hears my sayings and does them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man which built a house and digged deep and laid the foundation on a rock. And when the flood arose, The stream beat vehemently upon that house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. Now, I've heard people preach that and say, see, that rock is Jesus, and you got to have your house founded on Jesus. In a roundabout way, but if you're going to be specific, that's not true. It is founded, Jesus said, he hears my words and does them. He is a person who builds his house on rock. So the rock that you're building your house on is the words of Jesus. Not, see, when we say, well, your house is built on Jesus, what that is true, because Jesus is the Word. But what we usually mean whenever it's said in church is, you, if you accept Jesus as your Savior, now your house is being built on the rock. That is not true. Your house is not built on the rock by accepting Jesus as Savior. Your house is built on the rock by you hearing and doing His words. Right? And he could not shake it, and could not shake it, for it's founded upon a rock. But he that hears and does not is like a man that without a foundation built a house upon the earth, against which the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great. Why? Because it wasn't founded on the rock. Again, he talks about hearing and doing his words. So if you get down to it, it all goes back to hearing or doing. You'll see that all the way through. It comes back to what you do. Now, and believe me, if you don't believe, you're not going to do, for the most part, right? Now, you can do and still commit sin. See, that's what's been wrong in the church. There's been, we say, well, you know, yeah, we're out healing the sick and we're praying for people, but, you know, I still have this problem. You ain't got a problem, it's a sin. And you can stop sin, right? But in the church, see, because we don't want to run people off a lot of times, we don't preach against sin, and we don't tell them that sin is death. And if you remain in sin, you keep sinning, it doesn't matter if you lay hands on the sick or not, you're still going to go to hell. We don't want to say that. See? We want to tell them, it's okay, don't worry, God is working that out of you. And then that's where we come up with the idea of sanctification, meaning you get saved today and you're sanctified, and then you sin a little less every day until you die. That is not in the Bible. In the Bible, the new birth was the killing of the desire for sin. That's why I sometimes question how many people are actually born again in the church. Because if you ask people who's sinning, if they were honest, most people would have to raise their hands. Why? Because we haven't been taught truly that we're supposed to be out of it. That we're supposed to die to it and not sin. And yet you ask somebody, well, did you sin? Well, you know, we got sin every day. Really? Well, you know, what's the sin? Well, you know, so what did you steal today? Well, I hadn't stole anything. Well, did you lie? Well, no. Well, you commit adultery? Well, of course not. Well, then, and you go through the whole list. Then you hadn't sinned. Well, you know, then it was a sin of omission, and it was this thing. What? Now, there's a difference, because there are things that say that will take you to hell, but there's also things that you work on, but they're not sin. Right? You need to go ahead and study this out, because what we've done is we've seen partial truth, and we've made it to where we have to accept sin, because we don't know anybody that's walking free from sin. And we've made our experience the rule instead of the Bible. So sanctification is supposed to separate you from sin unto holiness. Now, you can't be separated from sin to holiness and still be sinning. That's where this idea comes from. No matter what I do, Jesus doesn't see me. He sees me through the blood, and I can do anything. And the Bible says I can't sin anymore. So now I can drink, and it's not sin. That's what's taught. Now I can do anything I used to do when I was sinning, but now it's not sin because now I've accepted Jesus, so I can't sin anymore. So obviously whatever I'm doing is not sin, even though what they're doing is still sin. And that's, believe it or not, that's big. So in Matthew chapter 7, he says, you shall know, and it's the same story basically, you shall know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles? Even so every good tree brings forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree brings forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that brings not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Hear that? The fire. If a tree does not bring forth good fruit, it's cast down and it's chopped down and cast into the fire, right? So you must have fruit. Not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? And in your name cast out devils, and in your name done many wonderful works. You say, aren't they doing his will? Yep, But there's a part of his will they're not doing. Because he says, and then I will profess unto them, I never knew you, depart from me, you that work iniquity. See, they were in their sin. Isn't that right? They were still working iniquity. And he said, you were doing all that stuff, and I never knew you. People say, well, they didn't really do it. They were just saying they were doing it. That's pure speculation, because here it says people are going to come saying they did it. So, and we got people in churches today that do that very thing. You ask them, well, do you, at y'all's church, you know, do you believe in casting out devils? Oh, yeah, we believe in casting out devils. Really? When was the last time you laid hands and cast out a devil? When's the last time you did it? Well, I ain't never actually done it, but our church believes in it. But then you ain't done it. Right? There's people in the church that the people in the church has done it, but you haven't done it. So you've not done the will of God. Right? And here's the other people that are still workers of iniquity. That's what I'm telling you. Jesus made no excuse for it. Get out of sin. Then he said, therefore, whosoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. The rains descended, floods came, wind blew, beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that hears these sayings of mine and does them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. The rain descended, floods came, winds blew, beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. And it came to pass, when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine. Why? Because he was speaking forcefully and absolute. That's one of the key common indicators of an apostolic ministry. They speak with strength, but they speak in absolutes. And they're not afraid to say, this is the way it is. Which is one of the problems in the church, because nobody wants to say how it is, because you might lose half your congregation. You know, why do we think that we can pull a church together of 20,000 people, and just because we got 20,000 people, we got a church of 20,000 people? Because the Bible says that there's going to be a few. Isn't that right? So why do we think that just because there's 20,000 people there, that we have a church of 20,000, when actually you might have 20,000 people in the building, but you might only have a church of three? You understand what I'm saying? Three that are actually born again. Three that are actually walking with God, that kind of thing. So it's not about numbers. It's about, that's what I'm saying, if you preach truth, you may not have big numbers, but the few that are there are going to be walking in the truth, because they won't stick around. Because most people don't want to do it. Well, guess what? Nobody's making anybody leave, but people cut themselves out because they decide, I don't want to do it. So, he says, in 1 John 2:14, I have written unto you, fathers, because you have known him that is from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that does the will of God abideth forever. And he's here what he's saying. What I'm trying to get you to is a point where you realize that you may need to be making deeper commitments to the fulfillment of God's will. That you may actually have to show up in the army you've already enlisted into. You know, we always say stuff, well, everything I have is God's. Really? Now, then why isn't more of it being used for his kingdom? You know, well, but brother, you know, we got to have a savings. You know, we got to have this money built up at some point. Why? You say, but you're talking crazy, man. Really? Jesus didn't have a savings. He had heaven. And he knew whatever he asked for, God would give him. See, I'll be honest with you. I know I am preaching a radical doctrine. I know it. Unfortunately, it just lines up with the Bible. Because God, this world that Jesus died for is worth you living for. And how can we say that we're living for God's will and trying to accomplish it, when in actuality we're living to prepare for a good future? You know, you could have a bunch of money in the bank, and it could be worthless overnight. Worthless. You know, I've seen that kind of stuff. You know, whenever the 9/11 things happened, and the government locked down on certain bank accounts and things like that, they could do the same thing. They could lock down, you know, through a national emergency or any type of situation, they could lock the bank accounts up. You ain't got a thing. Can't get nothing out. Can't use it for anything. What are you going to do then? Well, but, you know, I got to have a savings account because I got to prepare for the future. Well, what if your future gets locked up? If that's what you were believing in, then your God just got locked up. You can't get to it. And like I said, I know this is radical, but I love what Paul said. You know, that it was, he was willing to spend and be spent for the cause of Christ, for the gospel. And I just think sometimes we get comfortable just being preached at, you know, or even just preaching. And we are into this religious thing as opposed to a mission of trying to save the world. You know, and if you don't like what I'm preaching, well, blame William Booth, because he sure opened my eyes to a lot of stuff. You know, and I'm not trying to be the, you know, a social organization. But you can't truly be a spiritual organization unless you're a social organization too. Because you can't tell your brother, be warmed and be filled, when you got it in your capability to make him warm and filled and not do it. See, and then we got all our excuses. Well, you know, they got themselves in this situation. Yeah, that's not always true. And even if it is true, you got yourselves in some situations too. And usually somebody had to help you. So, you know, honestly, we got some more to read here, and I'm going to send you on out, I guess, here in a second, but I can be honest with you. I don't know where this is all going. You know what I mean? As far as the ministry and stuff, because I've asked God about that. I've asked him, you know, are you changing us to something like a Salvation Army type thing, or, you know, to that degree, you know, where that's, where we're focused on that, or what's going on? And I don't know. All I know is that we just keep preaching truth. And then we live in what we preach, and we try to walk in what we preach. But at some point, we've got to touch the world, and it can't just be, you know, Jesus loves you and get saved. It's got to be a life. If you're, you know, are you totally different in your life? Is your not just your finances, but everything, your thought life, is it all different? Or have you settled down into being normal and being going to church on Sunday and still doing pretty much everything else everybody else does during the week? And just being comfortable with that and just saying, well, this is what we do. And you're more spiritual. You listen to tapes. You listen to CDs. You listen to worship music maybe. You know, but yet, is your life really different? Or is it, or are you just into religion? You know, is this just what you're into now? Used to, you did something else, and now this is your new hobby. We wouldn't call it that, of course. But if somebody looked at your life, would they say, man, that person, I just don't get it. I don't understand them. Because if they can still understand you, you're not living Christianity yet. Because Jesus said, they didn't know me and they won't know you. Isn't that right? So if they can still understand you, what level of Christianity are you walking in? If they can, if your goals and your plans and your dreams are still the same that you had when you were in college, you know, back as a kid or whatever, and you were looking at it and saying, that's what I'm going to be, or this is what I'm going to do, and I just want to have. Are you really different whenever you got saved? How much of a difference did, how, and what I'm saying is, how much of your life did you give over to him? Was it just your future in eternity? Or is it your here and now? You know, I did a message one time that I was dealing with. I told people that what we have, you know, if you join a company, before you get any benefits, you got to be full-time. Isn't that right? But yet in the church, we got a lot of part-time Christians who want full-time benefits. You know, everybody wants to run to God when they get sick. But when somebody else is sick and they're well, they don't want to run to them. And see, our life is not ours. We're soldiers, which means you do what you're supposed to do and what you're told to do, and not just live a life of, I don't want to say luxury because or ease, because most of you say, well, I don't live luxury or ease, but believe me, go to a third world country, you live a life of luxury and ease. But somehow we got to make a difference. And, you know, I thank God for this message because this message has made an impact. It's changing lives. And the main thing it's leading to is more so than just healing. It leads people to be active in doing the will of God. You know, people are being activated to do and to move out and to touch lives. But we can't settle into that and just be that. It has to permeate every aspect of our life. You know, if you would picture yourself for just a second, not too long ago I was looking up, we were doing some teaching on, matter of fact, I would encourage you, if you can't get a hold of the teaching we did on Mission Revolution, and it's not about revolution in missions, it's about your mission is a revolution. And in preparation for that, there were some things that I studied, and one of them was the life of Che Guevara, who was a communist revolutionary. And, you know, I didn't agree with his ideology or any of that kind of stuff, obviously. But what I was looking for was the mindset of a revolutionary. How do they think? And there's several others. There were other ones I looked at, too. But it was amazing to me. He wrote to a friend of his and said, come quick, when he was trying to overthrow Batiste and put Castro in power. And he said, come quick, come to Cuba quick. He said, this war isn't going to last long, and it's worth taking a bullet for. Now, think about that. Just a communist wanting to overthrow a natural government, and yet look at what we have, and we act like it's not worth taking a bullet for. You know, how dedicated are we to it? And that's when I started telling the guys, if we were really focused on causing a revolution and changing and getting the message out there, how would we think? We would think like these revolutionaries do. When you go into a town, you have all these handbills, and you go out in the middle of the night, and you put them up on the telephone poles, and you plaster them on walls, and you put them out there, and you give away materials. In 77, the Ayatollah Khomeini was exiled out of Iran, and he was put into Jordan, I think it was, if I'm not mistaken. And for 2 years, he could not preach to any of the people in Iran. So for 2 years, he made tapes of all of his messages, and he preached on these tapes. And then they smuggled thousands of these tapes into Iran and gave them away and just started passing them around. And within 2 years, the Shah was overthrown, and they flew the Ayatollah Khomeini from Jordan into Iran and put him in power. And that entire country was overthrown. The government was completely overthrown in the space of 2 years, without a shot being fired. And they actually called it the Cassette Revolution. And when I read that, because I was doing some study on Islam and what a threat it is, and believe me, it's a lot more than most people hear. You know, I'll just be honest with you. You want to know probably the closest truth that's been on television right now concerning Islam? It's not on TBN. It's on CNN. It's called Glenn Beck. I'm telling you. He's got some insight. Now, I don't believe everything on CNN, obviously. But I'm telling you, I've done the research, and I told my wife and told some other people, and then I heard him repeat it, and I heard where he's going, and I'm telling you, you know, without getting all political and stuff, Islam is probably, it's the second greatest threat to America and to Christianity in the world. And the first greatest threat is the apathy of Christians. It's the only thing that's worse. And I started looking at this stuff and seeing the truth of it, and then I read about this Cassette Revolution, and I thought, man, my mind just started reeling. I started thinking, they overthrew a country with cassettes. Well, we got CDs. So I started thinking, if we could ever get to a place where we can afford to just give all of our stuff away and just make thousands of copies and just give it out and spread it. If we're focused on spreading a message, that's what we'll do. If we're focused on building an empire, then you got to build a following and build a base and a financial base and all that kind of stuff. I don't want that. I didn't sign up to that. You know, I could have been in business. I could have done all that stuff. I didn't want it. God didn't call me to be a CEO. I want to preach the gospel, and I want to change lives. And I'm looking for a revolution. I'm telling you, I can see it. It's coming. And if we can get the message out there, I believe that God wants this message to be the standard message in charismatic churches. Across, message of dominion, life, healing, victory. And, you know, they've already got a lot of that out there. But I believe they're missing some key vital parts. And if we can get it spread out there, but it's going to, the only way the churches are going to change is when the people in the pews get fed up and start saying, we ain't taking this no more. We want truth. And whenever we get enough of it into the people and the people start saying, preacher, preach this or I'm leaving. That's what it's got to get to. And it's coming. Amen? Then he says, I'm going to have to send you out of here quick. Matthew 22, verse 34. But when the Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him and saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Now, we've already read this before, just a minute ago. And Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And then he added, And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Matthew 7, 11 through 12. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good gifts, give good things to them that ask him? Therefore all things, whatsoever you would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them, for this is the law and the prophets. Now we had just read this also, but I wanted to expand it after I had a chance to bring the other in. Notice when this was brought in, he said, they ask him, Jesus is talking about, if you being evil can give evil, then how much better is your heavenly Father? And he says, therefore, because your heavenly Father is so good that he will give you whatever you ask, then do for others whatever they would ask, right, that you would want done for you. He said, and what are you doing? You're being like your heavenly Father. He'll give you whatever you ask. You go to them and say, what do you want? And then you give them whatever they ask. Now, understand what I mean by whatever ask. Obviously, we're not talking about giving alcohol to an alcoholic, right? But you do to them what you would want done for you. But he said, don't hesitate. Because your heavenly Father will give you whatever you ask. You go to them and you say, what do you want? Look at you. You're crippled. Yeah. Would you like to be healed? Yeah. Heavenly Father? And the Father says, yeah, go for it. Now, I mean, you know, we don't wait for a word. I'm telling you that. But I'm trying to illustrate the process. Because God is good, he wants you to go and be good to other people. And that means whatever needs to be done, right? And then he says, notice that, right after that is when he brings it up and says, he says, if you do these things, you will fulfill the law and the prophets. I'm telling you how to walk in righteousness. Then he turns around and says, enter in at the straight gate. Because broad's the gate that leads to destruction, like I said a while ago. And he goes through this whole thing. He said, that is the narrow gate, that you do to others what you would have done to you. See, I know this has been taught differently. I know that that part has been brought out separately. But I'm telling you, you got to take it in context. And in context, that's what's being said. We always want to break it up. Now, last part here. Yeah. Moral obligation is binding upon all humanity. Sinners are required to obey moral obligation. Sinners are also responsible to act according to the principle of moral obligation. Just because they are sinners does not release them from the laws binding upon all humanity. They are sinners because they do not obey the principle of moral obligation. They're not living according to the greatest good of all mankind. They're living according to the greatest good of them. What benefits them the most right now? If they would obey the principle of moral obligation, they would immediately begin to love God and their fellow man, treating everyone they want to be treated the way they want to be treated. Being a sinner does not excuse them from doing what is right. You understand that? A lot of times we look at sinners, well, yeah, but they're sinners. Yeah, but what makes them sinners is they're not doing what's right. And we make an excuse for it and say, yeah, but that's because they're sinners. No, they're sinners because they're not doing what's right. You understand? Almost like circular reasoning again. But he comes back to basically say, you're trying to excuse them because they are sinners. And what I'm telling you is the reason they're sinners is because they won't submit to God and do what is morally obligated upon them. God didn't have a different law. Now watch, he says, moral obligation is the basis of the law of Moses. And the law was given to bring us to Christ. That's what Galatians tells us. To show sinners how they are not living up to God's standard of holiness. to all who are not under grace, they are under the law. Right? Therefore, the law still applies to them, an eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. It's not, oh, those poor sinners, they don't get it. They're not poor sinners. They are rebels against God. Now, you have to go to them and present the truth and tell them, you're killing yourself. You need to turn. But you don't give them a false hope of, well, you know, God doesn't want you to go to hell. Now, he doesn't, but that's not the, you know, the reason that he came, per se. We have to realize that God wants obedience and submission to him. And that's the greatest good of the universe. And people are in rebellion against him. Christians are required to obey moral obligation. Christians are no longer under the law, meaning that they do not look to the law for their righteousness. They look to Christ. And since Christ fulfilled the law and now lives in us by his Spirit, we also fulfill the law. We fulfill the law the same way he did, by loving God and our fellow man, right? By loving God with all his heart, soul, and strength, and loving his neighbor as himself. This is how you can always know what to do in any situation dealing with humans or God. That's how you do it. You don't need a leading. You follow those two principles. If you're dealing with humans or God, then you love God. What falls under love for God? And if you're dealing with humans, then you say, what falls under love for my fellow man? And if you do what falls under those categories, you will always do what's right. And when you do them, I got news for you, that is the Spirit of God working in you to accomplish his will. It's at the same time. It's not separate. Then in non-human situations, such as which job to take or where to move, things like that, you may need specific direction. You may need to ask God, what about this? Give us some insight here. So I'm not against God speaking to you or you being led. I'm just saying there's ways you can know what's right and what isn't. Moral obligation requires reproduction. Moral obligation requires that every morally responsible being dedicate their entire life to the ultimate good of the universe. What is right for one must be right for everyone. The Bible gives principles or strategies to live by and examples of the tactics used to apply the principles. You have a responsibility. Over and over again, Jesus taught us that if you see someone, mainly in the parable or the story of the Good Samaritan, he showed several different people. Some were supposed to be, or they were accounted as righteous by the people there, but they walked right on past and didn't help. And he showed us that if you're going to walk with God, you should help, even those that you're not supposed to help. You understand what I mean by that? Even those that you're not supposed to be around, even those you're not supposed to touch. We have to realize that people need help and we're supposed to help them. Now, I hope you see how I'm trying to tie the spiritual and the physical meeting of needs together by showing love for God and love for your fellow man. But it all works together. But you do not... See, we always talk about people having a free will choice. You do have a free will. But you don't have a choice. See, you can choose to obey or not, but you don't have the right to choose not to obey. Because if you choose not to obey, you're going to be guilty. If you choose to obey, which is the only right choice, then you walk in line with God's will. So you really don't have a choice, but... I mean, basically, you come back down to, is it right? If it's right, do it. Not if it's right and it's easy, if it's right and it's convenient, if it's right and it's affordable. It doesn't have any of that. It just says, if it's right, do it. But we think we use wisdom whenever we're not using wisdom, but usually we're using cowardice. And we're trying to hold on to something. And if you ever realize that you have to be absolutely honest and truthful. Most of the time when you say, I can't, you should be saying, I won't. Because really you could. I'd love to do more, but I can't. Really. You see, we've already done our offering, right? Okay, so everybody knows I'm not pulling for an offering. Okay? I want to make sure you just hit me. It's like, what? Watch it, Danny. You're getting too much like a preacher. No. But the reason I say that is because I'm not trying to get your money. I'm trying to get you to recognize that money is not your God. And that if you truly believe that God has blessed you and brought you finances, then you should use the finances for things that bring glory to God and he will bring you more finances. You see? At some point, we got to make the change. We got to be different. It's never easy to be different. And especially when you might be some of the first to be different, it's really hard. But at some point, you stand out. It works. And before long, if you keep standing, you look back and there's more behind you. And then after a while, you create this groundswell. And before you know it, the mass is like you. At least the ones you're around. You know, because the others won't have you around. Okay? So, all right. Let's finish up with this. There's one principle of war, and that's this. Hit the other fellow as quick as you can and as hard as you can where it hurts him the most when he ain't looking. If you want to tie up all these nine principles together, there it is. Okay? And this was actually spoken by a general at one time. I don't have his name in here. I don't remember the name, but there was another man that was talking about it, and he said he was studying in war college, and he was studying the principles and trying to get them all down. And he asked him, he said, "What are you doing?" This general said, "What are you doing, son?" He goes, "Well, I'm trying to study the principles of war, sir." And this general answered back, just off the cuff, which I thought was amazing. And he said, "There's only one principle of war, and that's this. Hit the other fellow as quick as you can, as hard as you can, where it hurts him the most when he ain't looking." Now, I don't know what the guy made on the test that he had to take, if he had to write that down. But that's pretty good. And if you remember that, then pretty much everything else is going to work out as you start to apply these principles of spiritual warfare. Because, now, again, there's no way I could give you all of it. It would take years to go through, explain every detail, all these kind of things. But if you will, see, you've got to do this. I can't do it for you. You know, I can teach you how to minister to the sick. You still got to get out and go minister to the sick. Well, I can teach you the principles, but you're still going to have to go home and dig out. And as you start to walk through these things, you'll see them, and you start making notes, and you start teaching it. You know, you say, "But I don't know enough to teach it." What? Nobody ever does. But you start. And never be afraid to tell somebody, "I don't know." Because if you do that, it's better to tell them that than to make up an answer. Because if you tell them you don't know, at least they'll respect you for being honest. But if you tell them you do know, and then you give them some canned answer that doesn't even apply to the situation, then they're going to say, "Why didn't you just tell me you didn't know?" That's what they're going to say. And what happens is, here's the thing. If you don't make the change from the new covenant to the old covenant mindset. I'm sorry. Look at how my dear. If you don't make the change. Yeah, you don't have to make much of a change to go to the old covenant. If you don't make the change from the old covenant to the new covenant mindset, then what you're going to do is you're going to get, because you got to give yourself to this. You got to go into it, study it, apply it. If you don't, and you maintain where you're at, but you hear the teaching and you share it a little bit here and there, then somebody's going to start asking you questions and you're going to be okay for a while. But if they keep studying, they're going to get to a place where they're going to ask you a question, you don't know the answer, and then you're not going to have an answer from a new covenant mindset. And you're going to revert back to your old covenant answers because you want to answer everybody that asks. And you're going to pull out an old covenant answer and you're going to make an answer that contradicts what you've already been telling them. So you have to be renewed in your mind to the new covenant, which means walking like a son, not like a servant. Remember, you're God's son, man's servant, but the devil's master. So you have to walk like a son. And the only example of walking like a son we have is Jesus. And that means that you're going to have to talk like him. All right? And when you do, you're going to get flack. Because people are going to say, "Who do you think you are?" That's the way it is. When you start talking like him, you're going to start talking bold. You're going to start talking with authority. You're going to start talking. And then people are going to say the same thing about you that they say about Jesus. They were astonished at his doctrine. "I can't believe he would say that. I can't believe that. That's borderline blasphemy." It would be for a servant to say, but not for a son. See, that's the difference. Amen? All right, let's all stand up. Now we're going to break here for just a minute, and then we're going to come back and do the partner meeting. So we're getting out of here a little bit early, so I can still have you out here by 5 probably. So we're doing okay. All right, let's say this. Say, Father, in Jesus' name, I believe your word. I'm born of your spirit. You are a warrior, and I'm a warrior. I have your spirit. Your spirit in me. causes me to triumph.
Doesn't cause me to lose.
So I will walk in your principles.
I'll walk in your word.
I'll be a doer,
not just a hearer.
And I believe
that you dwell within me.
You walk with me.
You speak through me.
When I'm in a situation,
you are there.
When I open my mouth,
your spirit comes out.
And victory is attained.
My job
is to set the captive free.
My privilege
is to complete your will.
I take the obligation.
It's not burdensome.
It is light.
And it is joyous.
And I will do it.
You are my God.
And I do love you.
With heart,
mind,
soul,
and strength.
And I do
love my fellow man
as myself.
And I will treat them
the way I want to be treated.
I will give freely
because you gave freely, Father.
And in Jesus' name,
I thank you
for your spirit
that accomplishes all things.
And together,
we are workmen,
and we will work together
to accomplish your will.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
So be it. Amen.
All right, well, we're going to break, and then we're going to have a meeting that's going to deal with, it's going to be basically a partner meeting. If you are